really gonna die, you know, because he'd been out there forever. He didn't know which way. He said he couldn't see 1 inch in front of him. And then the sun came through finally because the fog passed. And then he saw all the reflections of the light in the water.
An has been painting his water series of artworks ever since. And now 11 of those pieces are on display at LACMA for an exhibit called Unexpected Light. Up close, you'll notice his meticulous strokes leaping off the canvas like waves.
Different colors, different shapes, and different layouts. But then when you step back, you see something else. And I think it's that interplay between far and near that really gives a sense of dynamism to Yang Yilan's works.
An had another brush with death in 2014 when he suffered a stroke which severely limited his mobility and speech. Within a year, he was back at work to create this painting. It reflects his despair and later optimism while recovering. Notice the specks of yellow peeking through the darkness.
So there's that contrast of the dark colors and then that slight, you know, holding out for hope.
Are you better artist after stroke?
I hope so.
And he's also the type of person, he's so young at heart, he's like a kid, that he's always hoping to become a better artist even further in the future.
Like the sea, An's work is always evolving, even at the age of 83. But with one constant, the radiant colors of the Pacific when relief and sunlight finally arrive. Reporting from LACMA, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
An's work is on display at LACMA's Hammer Building and at the Long Beach Museum of Art. A fateful connection that gave birth to some of our most iconic 60s music, now Valley Street Corner. We're talking about two founding members of the band The Doors. As Anna Marco shows us, city leaders are helping celebrate a piece of history.
Come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, baby, light my fire.
The legendary Doors band member Jim Morrison may be long dead, but his name lives on in a San Fernando Valley intersection, along with the name of his former co-founding band member and drummer, John Densmore. Densmore, who is still alive and likes signing autographs, helped Councilmember Paul Koretz unveil a new street sign at this Valley intersection, with his and Morrison's namesakes to mark the Day of the Doors, a celebration started by the city last year. It falls on the anniversary of a Doors album, and Densmore did a little singing of his own.
Are you a lucky little lady in the city of lights, or just another lost angel? City at night, city at night.
Okay, so these street signs weren't actually named for Jim Morrison and John Densmore. The street signs had been here for decades earlier, but it was a happy coincidence that helped Densmore discover them.
I suspect the original street signs were here for decades, probably around the 50s. But apparently John was driving past and noticed that not only was there a Densmore Avenue that he'd been aware of for years, but there actually was a Morrison Street that intersected. And it was just too perfect. It's just a wonderful little bit of LA history.
And now, more than 50 years later, fans have come out to see Densmore, though the event got no official publicity. Many of the fans born decades after the Doors' heyday.
He's looking healthy.
Jim was meant to make a big impact in a short period of time. I'm 73, and it's good to have other examples of how to do this living. And I'm on the long road. I regret losing Jim so young, but that just seemed to be his path.
The Doors, peace, love, rock and roll.
Light my fire, John! I love you! Woo!
We get the feeling this street corner just might become a Doors pilgrimage spot. I'm Anna Marcos for LA This Week.
Another founding Doors member, Robbie Krieger, is also still alive. While turning now to the city's Arcycle LA program, the next group to get free refurbished computers, young teen moms, who say the technology will help get them on the road to success. Rasha Goel has more.
Yana, I'm here at McAllister High School, where hundreds of young teen moms have received a recycled and refurbished computer. Now, for some of these moms, this gift will go a long way. Among those moms is Moo Morris, a senior at McAllister High School. She tells me how much this means to her, considering she doesn't have a computer at home.
For me, it will help me a lot because this is my last year and I want to start college and I am working currently, and it will be a lot more helper. When I'm home, I can study more.
The distribution is part of a recycle program which was developed by the city's Information Technology Agency and Council President Herb Wesson.
We take refurbished city computers with human IT that does the refurbishment, and they're providing jobs. We get sponsorship from companies like today eBay, in which they pay for the internet, and it's free of charge distributed to families in need.
What makes the program really a kick butt program is that we also work with Sprint, and they get what's called a hotspot, where they get free internet until the year 2021.
The city hired the nonprofit organization Human IT to upgrade the city's old PCs with the latest Windows 10 software. Over the last 3 years, the program has distributed more than 3,000 recycled computers.
The benefit of doing this is we're reaching out to all those families that are not able to get computers as well as internet. We're decreasing the digital divide.
And that's something many of these young women are excited about.
I believe receiving that computer will give us opportunity to expand our knowledge.
In a world that is geared towards being tech savvy, a priceless gift like this will hopefully help inspire these young women to reach for their dreams. In Los Angeles, I'm Rasha Goel for LA This Week.
The RCycle program is also a collaborative effort with the Department of General Services and the Bureau of Sanitation. A lasting tribute on what would have been LA Mayor Tom Bradley's 100th birthday. Gil Reyes reports on this campus honor for LA's first African-American mayor.
Cat! Hey!
LA Trade Tech College renames one of its buildings in honor of LA's first black mayor, Tom Bradley. Bradley's family, including daughter Lorraine, there for the dedication.
LACC, thank you so much. This is absolutely fantastic. It's just a dream come true. Yeah, really.
What was known as Redwood Hall is now called the Tom Bradley Center for Student Life, paying homage not only to the first African-American mayor in LA city history, but also the longest serving one. Mayor Bradley served for 20 years between 1973 and 1993. He graduated from Polytechnic High School in 1937. The original campus stood where LA Trade Tech College now stands. In fact, Mayor Bradley had attended classes in the very building now bearing his name, before going on to become one of LA's most respected leaders.
He knew that to govern effectively in Los Angeles, you need to listen to all voices, assimilate the best of what they have to say.
A hero to LA City Attorney Mike Feuer and LA Trade Tech College President Larry Frank.
He actually got me into law school. That changed my life, actually. He personally wrote that letter when I was late in my application.
The Tom Bradley Center for Student Life will partly serve as a mini museum dedicated to the five-time mayor, with documentary footage of his life and rare photographs, like this one with former LA City Council member Tom Labonge.
Whether they voted for him or not, he still loved every part of the city. He just cared about people.
A lesson for students on how to lead, how to live life. From LA Trade Tech College, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
The Tom Bradley Center also houses one of the city's WorkSource centers, offering job training and access to computers for those looking for work. Well, Abracadabra, a venue promoting magic and magicians, pulls off what could be its greatest trick: 55 years in the business of entertaining people. Gil Reyes reports from Hollywood's famed Magic Castle.
There's a party starting at the curious Gothic mansion on Franklin Avenue, the Magic Castle, an exclusive club for some of the world's greatest magicians, celebrates its 55th anniversary. Milt Larson is one of the club's founders.
I've lived all my life in LA. I love Los Angeles, and the castle is just a wonderful thing to have. And we have 5,000 members that love coming here and having a good time.
Hollywood's famed Magic Castle first opened its doors in January 1963, serving as the headquarters for the Academy of Magical Arts and drawing a who's who in the world of entertainment and, of course, magic. Members have included illusionists Siegfried and Roy and movie star Cary Grant.
I never dreamed, of course, that Cary Grant would ever walk into a room and say, "Hi, Joni, how are you tonight?" Much less get to know him and be wined and dined and hugged and kissed by him. Thank you, Bill and Milt.
Statues of founding brothers Milt and Bill Larson are unveiled. Bill and his wife Irene have passed away, but the family legacy lives on. To enter the castle, you have to know the secret password.
Open sesame.
You also have to have either a club member provide you a guest pass or stay at the Magic Castle Hotel next door. Waiting just beyond the bookcase is a maze of nightly magic shows, dimly lit bars, and a dining hall. Think Disneyland's Haunted Mansion for adults.
To the Academy of Magical Arts and the Magic Castle on 55 magical years. Here's to many, many more.
This is escape from the world. Come over here.
Reporting from Hollywood's mysterious Magic Castle, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
Visitors should know the club enforces a strict dress code. That means no denim or flip-flops. Business attire or evening wear is recommended. Well, what's your New Year's resolution? Maybe it's exercising more or a more positive attitude. Well, as Gil Reyes reports, kids in Pico Union have a chance to accomplish both, thanks to some much-needed gifts.
Even with darker days upon us, Megan Gomez rides out the winter with a bright outlook after receiving a brand new bicycle.
I'm gonna ride it. I'm gonna try to learn how to ride it. Because some children don't have toys, and this is an opportunity for them to come and go over here and get some toys.
This toy and bike giveaway at MacArthur Park was organized by the office of council member Gilbert Cedillo. 150 bicycles and 3,000 toys handed out to low-income families.
We are bringing a bit of joy and excitement, the spirit of generosity here to the community of MacArthur Park, Westlake, Pico Union.
The LAPD was also there.
Better report with the community and be out here in support.
In hopes of a safer, healthier, happier community in 2018.
We believe in you, we trust you, and we share your vision for a better future.
In MacArthur Park, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
Community donations helped make the giveaway possible. Well, city leaders work to identify homeless encampments. Two LA museums announced a new partnership, and an upgraded Metrolink app can save you some time during your commute. All these stories in City Beat. LA officials announced the formation of a special task force to survey high fire hazard zones in order to identify and clear out homeless encampments. The move comes after the December Skirball fire in Bel Air that destroyed six homes and was believed to have been started at an unknown homeless encampment in the Sepulveda Pass. Mayor Eric Garcetti and LA Fire Department Chief Ralph Terraza said the task force consists of personnel from the LAFD, the Los Angeles Homeless Services Authority, and the Bureau of Sanitation, and would provide a more proactive and systematic approach than what has been done in the past to identify homeless encampments in high fire hazard zones. Terraza said any encampments that are identified will be visited by LASA and Bureau of Sanitation workers to encourage the people there to move out while also offering them services.
We cannot take this risk to these individuals who may be the first to lose their lives, to the surrounding neighbors whose property and whose lives are threatened, and the cost of these fires as well.
The Los Angeles County Museum of Art and the Autry Museum of the America West announced a new partnership between the two city establishments. The two museums will embark on an evolving and collaborative approach for museums in the 21st century. This new LACMA-Autry partnership allows both museums to expand their programming content through the sharing of collections, joint programs, exhibitions, publications, and more. An updated Metrolink mobile app will make the daily commute easier and faster for thousands of passengers who transfer from Metrolink trains to the Metro system. The two transportation agencies provide a free transfer from the Metrolink trains that run through six Southern California counties to Metro subways and buses that run throughout LA County. But passengers must wait in line after getting off the train to get a paper transfer pass. Passengers who purchase their Metrolink ticket with the agency's mobile app can now simply scan their phone while skipping the line, saving an average of 5 minutes a day. People in downtown and Westlake don't have to go very far to enjoy a day of fishing. As Gil Reyes reports, kids can boogie on down to their own backyard, MacArthur Park, for a whopper of a time. MacArthur's
Park is melting. The park in Westlake inspired a hit song written by Jimmy Webb, covered by Richard Harris, as well as disco diva Donna Summer. But MacArthur Park is also a hidden gem for inner city slickers wanting to fish. A park with a history of crime, but as Sergio Talavera shows us, a place where you might also catch 30, 40, and if you're very lucky, sometimes 50-pound carp.
And this is MacArthur Park. It's known for its ups and downs, but today, as you can see, it's about the kids here today.
Talavera is with California Ghetto Carping. The group encourages fishing in urban areas and releasing the animals back into the wild. Through a GoFundMe account and donations from sporting goods stores, they've organized this Youth Fishing Day. First 25 kids receive free gear. And also today, no fishing license is required.
Not everybody has income to travel. So our main goal here is to bring awareness to the people in the city that they have a nice paradise in their own backyard.
The lake is full of fish. Come on down, bring your family, bring your children. And in turn, we can beautify this place. We can get together with community groups and pick up trash. We can sponsor sporting activities, dance activities. And I'll never have that recipe
again. As for recipes, you can bake, boil, or fry if you decide to keep it, and have a MacArthur Park everyone can enjoy. At MacArthur Park Lake, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
Within LA City, you can also go fishing in Lake Balboa, Cabrillo Beach, and Lincoln Park Lake. And remember, unless it's a special event, fishing licenses are required for people 16 and older. While punk rock takes center stage at Union Station, take a leisurely hike at Topanga State Park, and a classic Disney tale comes to Hollywood. All this in this week's Things to Do. If you're into punk rock and indie music, check out the band Joyce Manor, an American band from Torrance, California. With their first release in 2010, they became well known for playing fun and energetic music influenced by bands such as Jawbreaker, Descendants, Weezer, Thin Lizzy, and The Smiths. They've been described as reinvigorating pop punk with a sound both familiar and refreshingly original. So grab your friends and head to Union Station on Saturday, January 20th, for some truly unique sounds. Winter is the perfect time to hit the open trail in Topanga State Park, the largest state park in LA proper. This hike is a relatively flat, approximately 7-mile route that hits the well-known landmark known as Eagle Rock, and also ropes in Temescal Peak, which on a clear day can offer an incredible panorama of the city and mountains. And its combination of low elevation gains and great views make it nice and smooth for beginners. For more, visit parks.ca.gov. From the producer of The Lion King comes the timeless story of Aladdin, a thrilling new production filled with unforgettable beauty, magic, comedy, and breathtaking spectacle. It's an extraordinary theatrical event where one lamp and three wishes make the possibilities infinite. Aladdin is playing at the Pantages Theater until March 31st. For more, visit AladdinTheMusical.com. And that's a look at some things to do. Well, that's going to do it for this edition. I'm Yana Kane from all of us here at LA This Week. Thanks for joining us. A reminder that you can catch us online at lacityview.org. You can also follow and like us on Facebook. We'll see you back here next week for more of LA This Week.
Calls that don't belong on 911, where do we start? We have the usual, cat stuck up in a tree. I think my dog has a cold. What time is it? 911. It's about saving lives.
This is 911. I have bought some Chinese food and it's not a part.
You're calling 911 to get a husband.
Yeah.
Emergency.
Before Labrador, I called to get the time.
I need some single lamp.
How big is the spider?
It's just a little one.
Do you need a ride?
Yes, it looks for sure.
I asked for four different times to make me a Western barbecue burger. I want my hamburger right.
Holla, holla, sit down. Holla, low, holla, low. Me on move. Me on move. Holla, holla, sit down.
Sit down, low. 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 Sit down, low.
Okay, good morning. Good morning, everyone. If you please take your seats. Please take your seats. Today is Friday, January 19th. I want to welcome you all to City Hall. This council meets every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday. The public is welcome. Madam Clerk, we do have a quorum. Would you please call a roll?
Blumenfeld, Bonin, Buscaino, Cedillo, Englander, Harris, Dawson, Weezer, Koretz, Kikorian, Martinez, O'Farrell, Price, Rodriguez, Rue, Wesson, 11 members present and a quorum, Mr. President.
Okay, Mr. Price has arrived. Okay, so first order of business.
Approval of the minutes.
Kikorian moves, Koretz seconds. Next.
Commendatory resolutions for approval.
Rodriguez moves, Martinez seconds. That brings us where?
Mr. President, there are requests to receive and file items 1I and O, in as much as the liens were paid in full, to receive and file items 1P, T, and W, in as much as the properties are single-family dwellings and exempt from lien processing. Reduce item 1R to $488.56 in as much as the lien was partially paid. And finally, to continue item 1J to January 26, 2018, and continue items 1H and S to February 16, 2018, sir.
Thank you. So without objection, so ordered. Please continue.
Item number one is an item notice for public hearing, and Mr. President, there are cards on this item.
Okay, then let's continue.
Item number two is an item for which public hearing has been held.
Okay, let's take that item up. Please, Madam Clerk, open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Could you continue?
Items 3 through 7 are items which public hearings have not been held. 10 votes are required for consideration.
Okay, so without objection, those items are now before this body. Do you have cards on these items?
Yes, Mr. President. There are cards on 3 through 7, sir.
Then let's move on to the next set of items or the next item.
On the continuation agenda, item number 8 is an item for which public hearing has not been held. 10 votes are required for consideration, sir.
Okay, so without objection, that item is before this body. If we could just hold that on the desk for a moment. That brings us where?
Or that brings
a little early for the special.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's a little early, so council has items called special, general public comment, or presentation, sir.
Okay, so at this point, I'd like to recognize Mr. Weezer for presentation. Mr. Weezer, the floor is yours.
You just want to come on up here and give him support and stand behind him, so just in case he faints. Thank you, Mr. President. Come up. We could come up here. You know, one of the most important things we do as council members is listen to our community and their needs. And whether it is a community organization or an individual, the feedback we get is vital to the future and direction of the neighborhoods we serve. And for me, one of the most satisfying parts of my job is that after all these years of working together, many of these community members become our friends. And today I stand here before you to recognize one member of the Eagle Rock community whose lasting impact will be felt for years to come, not only in Eagle Rock, but in Northeast Los Angeles and the city of LA. I am proud to introduce you to my friend and the community of Eagle Rock's best friend, Bob Gotham. Let's give him a big round of applause. Bob has been a resident of Eagle Rock for over 30 years. In that time, he has become an advocate for moving the neighborhood forward. He is a steady and reliable presence in the community. But you might be surprised to learn that this advocate from Eagle Rock, who cares so much about the neighborhood is actually not from Los Angeles. Bob Gotham was born and raised in Boston. He attended Boston University, Mr. Bonin, the Bentley College of Accounting, and Syracuse University. Following his college days, Bob served 4 years in the United States Air Force, and let's give him a big round of applause for serving our country. Thank you very much, Mr. Bob. In the Air Force, Bob served in security service as a Russian linguist. Wow, that's something that I wasn't aware of. Good topic of conversation for the next time we have dinner, Bob. After his military service, Bob made his career in the banking industry. He worked in Boston and later in Jacksonville, where he climbed the ranks in the industry, and later moved to Tampa, where Bob...
Mr. Mizar, let me stop you for a minute. If I hear any more animal sounds from you, Mr. Spindler, or from Mr. Herman, you will be removed. So, Madam City Attorney, I have warned them at least twice today. So I'm so sorry to interrupt your presentation. Continue.
Thank you, Mr. President. He worked in Boston and later in Jacksonville, where he climbed the ranks in the industry and later moved to Tampa, where Bob became the manager of computer systems development for a company based in here in Los Angeles. In 1986, Bob was in the market for his first home, and his realtor mentioned a little neighborhood in the corner of Northeast Los Angeles, a little neighborhood called Eagle Rock. Bob had never heard of the neighborhood, but we were told that as soon as he walked into his house, he knew he was home. In 2002, Bob joined the Eagle Rock Association, which we affectionately refer to as TERRA. TERRA's focus has always been land use issues in Eagle Rock. Bob became president in 2009 and would serve in that capacity for the next 8 years. When he became TERRA president, Bob was continually asked what could be done to make Colorado Boulevard safer and more vibrant. Bob wanted to expand the focus of what TERRA did and suggested forming a small community group to work alongside TERRA to look at how public spaces on Colorado Boulevard could be improved. From this seedling of an idea, Take Back the Boulevard was born, a community-driven initiative that worked to improve the main commercial corridor in Eagle Rock. My office was brought in, and we began working very close with Bob and Take Back the Boulevard to turn his dream into reality. Take Back the Boulevard hosted 60 steering committee meetings and 14 large-scale community meetings as well. My staff and I attended a lot of these meetings, including one particularly contentious meeting where some wanted to leave things as they were, even though there were very significant things that needed to be improved on Colorado. We decided at that last meeting that we wanted to err on the side of safety and access, and we began implementing some of the aims of Take Back the Boulevard. We did phase one of improvements along the boulevard where we implemented a road diet that took away two lanes of traffic, and in its place we added bike lanes, two new crosswalks, and three new flashwalks. And this increased safety and encouraged a lot more pedestrian activity. Colorado still has four lanes of traffic, and one study found that by implementing our road diet, we decreased auto speed by only 1 mile per hour on average, yet reduced collisions along Colorado Boulevard by 42%. We would take that trade-off any day. But we didn't stop there. Our continued efforts and Bob's persistence has paid off. Literally, it has paid off in nearly $12 million in additional dollars in grants to further increase pedestrian access and safety along Colorado Boulevard. So we're going to install two new traffic lights, over 20 curb bump outs, and add pedestrian lighting on the 2 mile stretch of Colorado. These improvements would not be possible without Bob. We will break ground on the next phase of this exciting project next year. But Bob's involvement in the Eagle Rock community does not end there. In late 2016, I was sitting with Bob in my Eagle Rock office, and I asked him what he wanted to do next. Without missing a beat, he said it is time to address Eagle Rock Boulevard. Throughout the entire process of Take Back the Boulevard, people started to ask, well, what about Eagle Rock Boulevard? In 2017, he started Rock the Boulevard. I like the sound of that. Which is looking at the public space on Eagle Rock Boulevard between Colorado and York. With Bob's involvement and a loyal group of advocates in Eagle Rock, I have no doubt that we will have the same success on Eagle Rock Boulevard as we did on Colorado Boulevard. Bob has also served on the board of directors for the Center for the Arts, Eagle Rock, and is also a member of the Collaborative Eagle Rock Beautiful and the Eagle Rock Valley Historical Society. No one can achieve success alone, and Bob has had a great partner for the last 23 years. Bob met his husband, Michael, in 1995. They had a commitment ceremony in 1999, and like many others in the LGBTQ community, when they could, they were legally married in 2008. Congratulations to them both. Bob's impact.
You guys only been married so many years, they could still stand next to each other.
Bob's impact on the community of Eagle Rock and the city will be felt for years to come. And for me, it comes down to a very simple fact. Bob Gotham cares about the greater good of his block, of his community, of his city, of his state, and his country. I'm proud to call him a friend, and I'm proud to call him one of the fiercest advocates for the community of Eagle Rock. Everyone, please welcome Bob Gotham.
Welcome, sir. Welcome.
First of all, I'd like to thank my council member and good friend, Jose, for this recognition. I really appreciate it. There are not that many people in this room, or at least my people are sitting right over here, but there are many other people in this room. And amongst those people, I know that there are many other community activists. And I suspect that they would agree with my favorite African proverb, which is, if you think you're too small to make a difference, you haven't spent a night with a mosquito. I think we all can make a difference, and I'd like to think that this acknowledgement that I'm getting today is also a reflection of the council's acknowledgement of the importance of community activists, and I say kudos to all the others who are in the room. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you very much. A man of few words, but gets the job done. And here are a few supporters, family, friends, and friends from Eagle Rock who have all been involved in this effort as well in Eagle Rock. And I'd like to say that Eagle Rock is a small town feel in a large metropolitan area, but it has only been able to retain its character because of the activists who live there, people who get involved in the everyday activities, work with the neighborhood council, and work with the city council to get things done for the neighborhood. And Bob, you have been at the forefront of many of these fights, of these initiatives, but more importantly, you as a human being have just been someone that exhibits what it means to be an Angeleno, someone who cares about others, welcomes others, and gets things done for the city and for others. Congratulations, and on behalf of the City of Los Angeles, we'd love to present this resolution to you, recognizing all your hard work and you as a human being who cares for others. Congratulations, Bob.
Congratulations, Bob. Thank you. Thank you for your service.
We're going to go to the back and take some photos. So okay. I think my staff, yes. Sean will help you get back.
Thank you. Thanks.
Madam Clerk, you have some announcements?
Yes, Mr. President. There are requests to continue number 1E to February 9th, 2018, and number 1Q to February 16th, 2018, sir.
Thank you. Mr. Harris Dawson?
President, I have a special acknowledgement I want to make this morning. We have the men and women scholars in the ninth grade from Los Angeles Promise Charter High School in the Chesterfield Square neighborhood of the 8th District. I wanted to acknowledge them and welcome to their Los Angeles City Hall this morning.
Welcome. Stand up and let's put them on television. Welcome to City Hall.
They're joined by their, this is Mr. Matthew Mizrahi's ninth grade class. They're joined by their principal and our good friend Veronica Melvin, the president and CEO of LA Promise.
Good to see you. Let's give them one more round of applause. Thank you guys for coming down. We also have some students with us today from Azusa Pacific University. If you guys would stand up. Azusa. Here they are. Okay, again, let's give it up for Azusa Pacific. Welcome. Okay, Madam Clerk, why don't we go to the special agenda so we can recess the regular and move to the special?
Blumenthal, Bonin, Buscaino, Cedillo, Englander, Harris Dawson, Weezer, Koretz, Krikorian, Martinez, O'Farrell, Price, Rodriguez, Rue, Wesson. 13 members present and a quorum, Mr. President. Mr. President, items 9 and 10 are items for which public hearings have not been held. 10 votes are required for consideration, sir.
Okay, so without objection, so ordered.
And Mr. President, there are cards on 9 and 10 as well, sir.
All right, so this is what we'll do. I want to call up Mr. Previn and Mr. Walsh, Mr. Spindler, and Mr. Herman.
Thank you, sir. We're in the special meeting. Item number 10, I believe, is the expanding the firefighting force and restoring critical firefighting resources. I thought it looked like they were going to add a whole class, 48 positions or something. Now, up in public safety last week, there was a discussion of the SAFER grant, where the mayor's office had applied but forgot to tell Englander and the council up there. David Rue got a little upset that they had applied for this grant and won it, but it's a $9 million match. So they get $15 million, and Frank Lima certainly deserves some respect because this is a guy who we were going into that 0 for 12. Now we're 1 for 13. It's a big grant, and it's to put firefighters up in the to work. Now, the only problem is we don't have the money yet, so there's a little bit of a disconnect. We're not going to go out to cadets without getting the funding in place, are we? I mean, I don't know. This is a little bit shifty. These guys are good. They're very, very good, sir, and I don't think anybody's going to dispute that. The UFLAC department with the fire boot coming around the room, this is a good group, and they know what they're doing. So we do want to roll out the appropriate levels of service, but I think we should get the chickens not out in front of the carts if we can avoid that, sir. So thank you for that one. Now, if we could also get, and Jeff Gorell might be able to help from the mayor's office, a copy of the incident report, fire incident report for the Skirball fire. The battalion chief's hands are tied. He's got the $2.30. He wants the money. I'm happy to give him the money, but can we do it over at the mayor's office? Because they're dragging us down to another facility, sir, and I think it's a public record that maybe Kretz's office could actually help since they're the district in which that terrible incident took place, and we're going to get to the bottom of. Sir, thank you for your time, and I'll be back at the regular meeting. Thank you.
Okay. Next speaker.
Well, we're not too appreciative about how the fire department has modified its training schedule, have we? The harbor recruit training, I believe, is racist and biased, although it hasn't started yet. And why do I say that? Due to lack of minorities being signed up and recruited during these academy training services. And due to the resolution of the LA Fire Department, number 48, Firefighter 3, whatever the fuck this code position means, no one fucking cares. So the Civil Service Commission from January through June 30th was approved, but not with suggestion of the public. That's item 10. Now I'm going to go into item 9, Mr. Chair. So in CD5, as you all know who CD5 is, that is Paul Koretz, Peppa Pig. And relative to asserting jurisdiction, Central Los Angeles Area Planning Commission's action, property located at 6400 West Haynes Drive, we approval of certificate appropriateness for construction. Well, whatever the fuck that means, 873 square foot of additional space for a one-story, 1,370 square foot contributing structure, what the fuck does that mean? It means you're spending money that doesn't have to be spent on an old fucked up building. Provide our firefighters with the best. Let's make America great by providing our fire department with the best tools, the best equipment, and the best fucking firehouse you can find in Los Angeles. So fuck you, Herman.
Mr. Walsh.
John Walsh, blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org. Those charter school students got their face on television and they got their ass out of here. They have absolutely no interest. They're 100% LA types. That's the number nine. This is Planning Commission. Whenever you want, you're a developer, and you want a change in the rules, which means a violation in rules, you go to the Planning Commission, and then they tell you who to pay off, what person to pay off. As you know, the person who was paid off for Mr. Buscaino was murdered. He was murdered. No one gives a shit who killed him. We give a shit who killed him. This is not a joke. They played it down in the LA Times. Buscaino's deputy in charge of construction.
Let's get on the item.
Okay, you're not interested in this issue, and I'll bow to you, scumbag. Racist scumbag, because he wasn't black.
Mr. Walsh, stay on the item.
Okay. And then number 10, firefighting. We have spent millions of dollars on firefighting for other cities, for other counties, for other... We had them all down there fighting somebody else's fire, leaving this area in danger. That was what was the problem here. This area was in danger. No one gives a shit. Sennheiser's gay as a goose, and
you're
all
off
that
topic.
Takes is
thank
a...
You. Thank you, Mr. Walsh.
Thank
okay.
you, scumbag.
Mr. Bonin, I have you on the... Okay. So, Mr. Spindler?
Yes, go ahead. A new year, a new goat, pop it.
Yes. Yes, I want to thank you all for being the assholes you are. So we get to item nine, biggest asshole there. So, fucking item nine. What is the problem? What is the problem with the councilman Polkaretz? Everybody was paid off. The developer paid off everybody in the council office. Everybody paid off. Jeffrey Epstein was paid off. His wife was paid off and put on
Get
another
back
planning
on
commission.
On the subject, Mr. Spindler.
The developer is very, very mad. Yes, he's very mad about this fucking problem of building the shit behind his house. All he wants to do is build a piece of shit 873 accessory dwelling unit for his mother. His mother is sick, but you don't give a goddamn fuck about the elderly, no. So you want to disapprove something to help the old people get into their goddamn bathroom and take a proper shit in the 873 square feet. Fuck you. And then we get to number 10, firefighters. There are no black people being held as firefighters. There are no Korean firefighters. The only firefighters are a bunch of scumbag cocksuckers that you people are either related to or having sex with. Yes, that's what you do. You go and you fuck somebody in the ass and give them
no,
a job as a firefighter.
Thank you, Mr.
The
Spindler.
Biggest.
Your time is your time's expired. Okay, members, let's prepare to vote on these items. Let's take them up together. Please open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate.
13 ayes.
Mr. President, there is a request to have item 9 go forthwith, sir.
Without objection. Okay, we can adjourn and then return to the regular.
Mr. President, Council has general public comments or items called special, sir?
Let me ask if we could get Mr. Walsh's numbers on my screen. We'll go back to multiple. Mr. Walsh, 1A through 1C, then 3A, 5, 7, and 8.
Okay, John Walsh, blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org, and we are the citizens group fighting to find out who murdered Mr. Buscaino's deputy.
Mr. Walsh, you have to stay on topic. You can talk about
the topic
that
is the safety of Mr. Buscaino's. He doesn't give a shit. Kerkorian doesn't give a shit. He allowed. Okay, number three. These are REAP. You do a good job on that. See, if you do a good job, I'm not one of these white people who say, let's get rid of all the colored people and let's turn the city back into white. No, no, if you do a good job, I admit it. Number five. Okay, these are reward offers. As you know, you haven't paid out a reward offer in what, 5 or 6 years? Because if they pay out a reward offer, that person will be murdered by the gangs for testifying. We all know that. But the mayor doesn't care because he's getting money through back alley channels for his campaign for mayor, for president.
Let's stay on the subject, Mr. Walsh.
Are you listening? Okay, number five, reinstating reward offer. And number seven, this is a status report. Everything is 1.6 million here. Summer Night Lights, 1.6 million for what? Were you down there? Oh yeah, I think they're kickbacks here. Lots and lots of kickbacks on the Summer Night Lights report. Now, notice he didn't say that was out of topic. It is in topic. We know there are kickbacks, but the LA Times is in love with the mayor's shape of the mayor's ass. And
okay,
that's
why.
Okay,
let's give Mr. Walsh's 1 minute for general.
Okay. The mayor has, let's face it, a very, very cute ass. And most of the reporters in at the Times are as gay as geese. And when he just shakes his little booty, stories are killed. Stories are killed because of the shape of the mayor's cute little backside.
Mr. President, that is not within the subject matter of this jurisdiction.
Okay, so you have to speak on something that the city has direct or indirect relationship with, Mr. Walsh. You know that.
Thank you. Look, the mayor is directly in charge of the city. He kills stories, he kills investigations, he kills everything, and then he shakes his little fucking ass
okay,
at you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Walsh's time has expired. If we could bring
I think
up,
you must be gay,
could,
too.
If we could bring up Mr. Previn's numbers. Okay, Mr. Previn. 1A, 1D, G, R, V, W, then items 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8.
Thank you, sir. It's Eric Previn from CD2 in Studio City. Today at item number 4, we're doing a little $17,000 in overtime to the LA DOT. It's coming from Englander. He's been trying to get more LA DOT activity, and I'm not sure if that means citing his residents or not. It may do, but we're not sure about that. It may also mean helping facilitate certain permits and such. I don't know. Item number 5 is a reward. This is important, but what you're citing is when you last posted the award in August. It would be helpful to the public if we could help with the horrible finding of this murderer, if you tell us the date that the crime also, because it's just, and also maybe you should announce it instead of the constant lathering up, and it might be at least make a little sense to do that kind of thing. We do don't want to catch these kinds of people. Item number seven, sir, is another little, hey, let's take 1.6 million out of the HOPE teams, which last night, to his credit, Councilmember Krikorian had a town hall on homelessness. It was very well attended. There were hundreds of people there, and I applaud him for trying to do something, to talk about it. Peter Lynn was there from the LASA and a lot of people. And, you know, it was impressive. But HOPE teams, there are only four citywide. And so to cut 1.6 million, migrate it over to LAPD sworn overtime, raises questions about why we would do that at this moment when we're celebrating how we need more of those HOPE teams. So I don't know. I don't know. And HOPE, by the way, is not what you think it is. It's not as nice as it sounds. And regarding that, just to go circle back, sir, if I may, to the SAFER grant, imagine if you're a young aspiring firefighter, you come to a town and the committee hasn't yet decided that they're going to approve new positions because they need it for the overtime for wildfires next year. So I really think these guys ought to get their act together. And I think allowing Mitchell Englander to run the public safety cluster like a madman is not really helping some of the rank and file, but not just that, the public. So I don't know how to delicately approach that in a way that makes sense for the public, but I do want you to know, sir, that we are watching closely, we care about what you're doing, and we will be here going forward, so thank you.
If I could get, maybe we pull up Mr. Herman. Okay, you have 1A, 3A, B, C, D, E. You have items 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8.
Now that I have your attention, as it's so quiet in here, you all understand that when you have a violation, nuisance, a lien on your property, if you come and stand right here and contest it, the first question you should ask is, I never received registered, certified mail in demand of this lien, which violates your due process and your constitutional right to the quality of life and freedom and enjoyment of your home. However, incidentally, that doesn't happen here. As you can see, I have multiple pages of liens, and I'm here to demand that you hand a receipt to the person on item H and CD4 at 8312 West Utica Drive for that $3,000 lien, that you waive all the interest and damages and emotional stress you cause upon this family. Then I go into item number 5. Cedillo, we know that people in Cyprus don't have to die because we have terrible policing. We know people shouldn't have to die by a knife. However, this 22-year-old man in Cyprus in CD1 was a victim and killed. Then we have another problem. We have a 16-year-old from South Park. Everybody, South Park. And this 16-year-old, Robert Jermaine Harris, was killed on December 11th, a victim of a fatal gunshot, along with a gentleman from Inglewood on 11th place by the name of Kevin Robert Harris. What the fuck is going on here? Why do we have this capital murder city in the world, LA? I don't blame tourism. I don't blame people coming here from foreign countries, wetbacks, causing all the problems. The problem is lack of education, Mr. Harris Dawson. It's a lack of education and higher education to promote don't shoot, don't kill, and don't cause someone's death. And then in my last portion, number 7, regarding the first financial status report, fiscal year, amending, of course, Mitchell Englander is in here to represent the issue because we all know he's a racist.
Stay on topic.
And HOPE and teams and summer night lights. Well, I got summer night lights in my home, but the police department on overtime, to kill people, fuck you.
Give him his 1 minute.
Now we're going to build the wall. We are going to build a wall, and we're going to shut down Washington as of tonight, midnight. We don't need to go to the parks. We don't need any enjoyment in California or in the United States anymore, because those fucked up Democrats, anyone in the party of a Democrat, has fucked up our constitutional rights to enjoyment. Why? Because Donald Trump has asked, I'll pass all your bullshit, Democrats. I'll pass all the dual bullshit of Obama as long as I get my motherfucking wall. And I'm for the wall. To keep racist, biased, prejudiced, wetbacks from coming into my country and fucking it up. It's not my fault. Jose Huizar's from Zacatecas. It's not my fault. Another person in here, and you know her, it's right here, talking about tampons, hair products, deodorant. Well, you ought to stick a tampon in your mouth and keep your big fat butt shut up.
All right, your time's expired. Give me Mr. Spindler. You have 1 A, B, C, D, F, through G, no, through
dumbass
K.
Dumbass.
No, through X, and then you have 3A,
can't read.
B, C. Mr. Spindler, until I officially recognize you, would you please be quiet? Okay, now you have items 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Now go ahead.
Yeah, just trying to train my new advocate here.
No, you're going to stay on the subject or sit down. The choice is yours.
All right. So let's go. One.
Yes, I'd like to thank everybody who waived the liens. Thank you. But to those of you who did not waive the liens, fuck you in the ass. Because I do not want any liens against any property owners. Whenever you have a lien, you cannot feed your goat. You cannot feed your cat. Meow. You cannot feed your horse. And most of all, you cannot feed your fat fucking pig. And that is very important for goats. So we do not like liens. I am an advocate against liens. So you want to go to the next one?
I told you to read this shit. All right, so we'll take it over here. He's a new advocate. Number 8, a 6-fucking-year coordinated street furniture program from that J.C. DeCokes LLC. What the fuck? I rode buses for 2 months. Every one of these places that you have has no lighting. There's no Wi-Fi. They look like shit. They dirty, filthy, shit-filled goddamn places where you try to wait for a bus because of out front J.C. DeCokes LLC doesn't give a fuck about bus riders and doesn't give a fuck about any of us. Even Nuri Martinez complained about the condition of these bus stops. It must stop. No to this contract for 6 years. Look at the payoffs. Now, if the goat was reading, he would note that there's rewards for murders. Murders in Cypress Park. That's typical. They have a rap group named Cypress Park because it's such a death row. Yes to the reward. Then we get Marquise Harris Dawson's reward for who? You're not going to catch it in the hood. Murders are like Las Vegas in the 8th District. What stays in the 8th District remains in the 8th District. And in the 9th District, well, current Price doesn't even live in the 9th District. He lives in the 8th District. So why is he making rewards for the 9th District? He doesn't even live in his own district. So no to number 6, yes to number 5. And if he were here, which he's not, fuck Mitchell Englander at number 4.
Give him his 1 minute.
Now we get the Nuri drive. Bring your wrapped condoms. Bring your wrapped tampons to any box with a hole in it that you see with this sign. And there's a little song that goes with it. Nuri. Stopping human trafficking. We'll start first by shutting down Spearmint Rhino and all the strip clubs in the 6th District. Are we going to do that? No, because campaign donations don't go in the box. The box is for only the bullshit. Stop the human trafficking with the strip clubs and the motels with an M. Then you can stop the human trafficking. Nuri is just like the chair of this panel. Nuri is full of fucking shit. She doesn't give a shit about women.
Mr. President, there is an amendment for number 8, and it has been posted and circulated for council's consideration, sir.
Let's hold that item for now. We'll vote on items 3 through 7. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Now, can you put on my screen general public comment? Okay, Ahmad Butler, Carly Kirchen, and Carlos, Lydia Ponce, please come forward. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, and good morning to you all. My name is Ahmad Butler. I live in the city of San Pedro. I'm here to ask the members of the council to consider and pass the short-term rentals ordinance. I am a member of Unite Here Local 11. I've been a bartender for 11 years now, in the hospitality industry for about 13 years. A lot of people on the other side of this argument would say that the members of our union are in this for a monetary issue, but we are in this because we care about not only the health and wages of our workers, but we also care about their way they're able to live. And right now, most workers aren't able to live anywhere near where their hotels are at. We've lost over 4,000 rentals to short-term leasing rentals in Los Angeles, and renters like myself are having a hard time finding homes and places to live. I have so many members of our union who express this. Thank you.
Yes, please identify yourself.
Hi there, my name is Carly Kirchen. I live in Highland Park, and I am also here to urge the council to vote on the short-term rentals ordinance as soon as possible. Every single day that we do not have an ordinance in place, we are losing valuable housing for long-term tenants as opposed to tourists coming into town. As Ahmad said, we've lost over 4,000 units to short-term rentals, and every single day that number goes up. Please vote as soon as possible and talk to the folks on the Plum Committee. Urge them to vote as well. Thank you.
Carlos, Lydia Ponce, Ms. Henry, Elaine Cohn. Brian Barajas. Brian. Anyone in the audience that signed up for general public comment? Anybody? Come on down, sir, just identify. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you. So I just want to elaborate one and what we've been putting out at the LaRouche Political Action Committee, that if you look at the coup d'etat on Donald Trump, it is clear that the asshole Obama illegally surveilled Trump in his campaign. What that means is, and what is about to take place, is the treasonous actions by these people will be treated as such that the FISA court document to wiretap so-called the presidential system is about to be revealed, and people will go to jail for this. We need to join in a development program that Linda LaRouche has put forward his four laws in the Silk Road from China.
Next speaker, please come identify yourself. Your name, sir?
Did you call?
Your name, just state your name.
Did you call Bernd Lohrschmidt?
I just did. Welcome.
It's on your agenda item H, and it says up there it's been deferred. Ah, sorry. It's a lien item, and I want the. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Continue.
I thought it was going to be deferred. That's why I wasn't ready.
It's my understanding that your item has been continued. So what district was his?
Excuse me?
What area? What? So that's Mr. Rue. So your item has been deferred.
That's what I saw on the.
Yes, so if you would talk to somebody from Council District 4, we'll have somebody meet you over by the ropes, over where I'm pointing. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Come and answer your question. My pleasure.
My name is Elaine Cohn. I'm also here on Councilman Rue's district with respect to the lien on item number 4. We did submit a lengthy written.
Okay, well, unfortunately, you signed up to speak on general public comment and not on item 1. So if you go to the side, Mr. Rue will have someone over there to speak with you as well. Identify yourself.
My name is Ms. Henry.
Yes, Ms. Henry.
I just want to make a public comment on behalf of from District 9. For the last year, I've been living in District 9. Now I reside in District 10 for the last 4 months. And I'm very angry about a lot of things that are going on with women and sexual harassment, also with trafficking of young girls. I noticed a lot of prostitution in District 9 and it being supported by a lot of high-powered men and marijuana dispensaries support this from my own observation. And I've also been a victim of being in a relationship with a high-powered man and exposed to a small degree of trafficking, and I'd like to speak on the matter. At some point, I've joined my neighborhood council,
Thank you.
I'd like to bring that to you guys' attention. Thank you.
Next speaker, identify yourself.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Carlos Montenegro. I'm a California bail agent. I'm the owner of Boss Bail Bonds in the Lafayette Park area and the president of the American Bail Agents Union. I'm here to talk about a few things that that while I was as a bail agent working for another company, I couldn't talk about, but now that I have my own company, I can openly talk about it. I'm here to talk about black bail, no gypsy bail, and no prostitution bail. There is a standard, it seems to be taking place within the bail bonds industry, and that's I've worked at quite a few of them, where we would raise the standards if a person called and we were able to identify them as African American, we would raise the standard of bail for them, meaning that they would we would have to have more requirements for them, and we were told to do that by our managers. We were also told to deny prostitutes bail automatically, even though they have a right under the Constitution, under the Eighth Amendment, gypsies, we were.
Thank you. Again, let me call for Ms. Ponce. I don't see her. So with that ends general public comment. It's my understanding. I do have a Jose Ruiz and Jessica to speak on one of the item one related issues. Please come forward.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My father has a property, my father Jose Ruiz has a property in Sherman Oaks, and a lien is being contemplated to be placed upon it. My dad, I don't know if you would like to speak, but
no, just go ahead.
Feels that there was a mistake initially on the code violations. I don't know if I'm allowed to hand in paperwork for any kind of viewing or that I can leave regarding the violations and how they were corrected, and how once corrected, it was believed that the violations would be done, as well as the sightings of financial burden. Initially, the violation was about a backing up. My dad doesn't have a driveway. It was a backing up issue of his neighbor, and the neighbor needed to fix that clearing. The neighbor didn't do it in a timely fashion. It helped create costs against my father.
Thank you. Now let me, 1D. Mr. Root, we have Mr. Spindler and Mr. Herman. No more outbursts. We're trying to take care of some serious issues. Did you want to continue this item, or?
Can we put it on the desk so my staff?
Let's hold it for 1 minute, and if the two of you would come over to Sergeant, Director.
Okay. Thank you.
Madam Clerk, so what's still on the agenda?
Council has item number one as well as eight, sir.
Well, why don't we deal with item eight, as the conversation is now taking place on, I believe, item 1D. So item eight is now before this body. If I could go to Mr. Bloomingfield. Item eight.
Okay, and we have one amendment from Mr. Kerkorian and myself, which I'm taking as a friendly amendment, and that is it's doing several things. This has to do with the J.C. Deco contract extension, and basically this does a couple of things. It instructs the Bureau of Bureau of Street Services to conclude negotiations no more than 120 days, and to report to the Public Works Committee and the Budget Committee with the amended contract upon completion. And it also says if negotiations do not conclude within 120 days or otherwise result in an extension, to prepare a new RFP for a successor coordinated street furniture program. So that puts a little extra pressure on this contract. This is a contract that, you know, should have been renewed a long time ago. I think it was back in 2006 when the first look came on this. We need to move forward with something to get these transit stops to have the amenities that we want them to have. We want them to have more shade. We want them to have plugins for people's phones. We want them to be good for our transit riders. And the idea behind this is we want to get this negotiated and moved forward so that can happen. And so I'd like to accept Amendment 8A without objection, and I know there may be other amendments as well, but that's all I'm asking for.
Okay. Mr. Bonin?
Thank you, Mr. President. I fundamentally agree with everything Mr. Bloomingfield just said. I just had a question for staff, if they could come on up for a second.
Go ahead, Mr. Bonin.
Thank you, Mr. President. Just curious why the recommendation that we negotiate a renewal or an extension with J.C. Deco instead of going out to bid and seeing what might come of having a competitive process.
Good morning. Lance Luigi with the Bureau Street Services. The advantage of, we believe, of moving forward with an amendment at this point will allow the city to achieve the additional transit structures within several months of the amendment being passed versus waiting three years or more to see the a new RFP process run through. And then if we get a successor contract, it'll probably take that contract another 2 years or more to actually start rolling out new furniture. So we're looking at possibly getting new furniture within this year versus 5 years from now.
So it's a question of speed versus seeing what the competitive process might
yield. Correct.
And are there a lot of other companies out there that might compete?
We know of a couple, but it's a very, very limited field from what I understand.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Any other? Mr. Buscaina.
I'd like to speak on 8B.
Is that before us? Is that incorporated in this as well?
Yeah,
so there would be the appropriate time for you to speak.
Thank
on
you, Mr. President. Colleagues, I introduced 8B because I felt that the existing out front JC Deco agreement, never contemplating technological advances and other types of advertising in the public right of way, the city should have the ability to take advantage of best in class, cutting edge technology, which other cities have I've seen in my days with National League of Cities have successfully deployed to improve residents' lives and attract visitors. And all this does is keep the city's option open and ensures the city's hands are not bound in the next 10 years of technological advances. Now, our convention and tourism department has been partnering with LATCB for the last several years on a pilot program and has asked LATCB with developing a state-of-the-art interactive digital platform that would serve the needs of visitors, residents, city agencies, bids, and chambers. And this is one of LATCB's contractual deliverables to the city under its CTD contract. The platform that they're using right now is with interactive kiosk experiences, Smart Cities, that was selected by LATCB. And it provides a wide range of civic resources and social services, including integration of the mayor's 311 system. In addition, enables the city to push out key messaging across network, including street closures, city events, emergency notifications, and a host of other information that really focuses on key parts of the city where tourism is thriving. So the kiosk can only also provide a variety of functionality for the city, including security cameras, emergency call buttons, air quality monitors, and real-time public transit information. Now, this is not intended to be an advertising platform. It's first and foremost a content delivery system, and over 90% of its content is editorial in nature. And there are 6 sponsored content rotators that subsidize the program that can make it CapEx free to the city, not one dime the cost of the city. In addition, there's a dedicated rotator solely on specifically for city messaging, as well as extensive dedicated city content throughout. So I know LATCB, working alongside our convention tourism department, has said that this has been had an impact on really getting the message out to our visitors and tourists that are welcome to our city. And I ask for an aye vote on 8B. Thank you.
Mr. Blumenfield, wait a minute. I already indicated that if you made additional animal sounds that you were going to be removed. So I want to remove Mr. Spindler at this point in time. Mr. Spindler, remove him.
Get him out of here.
Remove Mr. Spindler. Mr. Spindler, please leave. You are continuing to disrupt this meeting. I warned you 3 times. Let's have him. I'm not going to let him take 10 minutes to leave. Just get your stuff and leave. Mr. Spindler is continuing, city attorney, to disrupt this meeting. Take Mr. Herman with him. No, Mr. Herman as well. You don't just holler out, Mr. Herman. There are protocols. You were warned too. So let's remove Mr. Herman as well. Remove them both. Why don't you just leave? Just leave, Mr. Herman. Come on, let's take care of both of them. Go ahead, Madam City Attorney. They are still disrupting this meeting. We're having to wait several minutes for them to exit these chambers.
And for the record, Mr. President, in case the cameras can't catch it, the two members, Mr. Herman and Spindler, are continuing to make noises and disrupt the meeting.
Sorry about that. Okay, we're back to you. I think it was you, Mr. Blumenfield.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise actually in opposition to Amendment 8B. I really appreciate what my colleague is trying to bring forward, and I am not opposed to, neither opposed nor supporting the technology that he's talking about. I think there's a real possibilities for these kinds of interactive kiosks. However, what creating a carve out for these kind of kiosks in this contract would have major implications on the contract before us, implications that we don't know. Right now, the city gets a certain percentage of the revenues from the bus furniture. If we carve out and remove the exclusivity of the right-of-way, which is the value of this contract, the contract will probably go down in value. That may more than be offset by the value of what he is proposing, but we don't know that. And to just put it in as an instruction after the committee has heard it, I don't think is a wise thing for us to do. What I have offered, and I will offer even if this amendment fails, is I would offer a compromise amendment which would send this idea back to committee for 30 days so that we can understand what the implications, financial implications and other, are of creating a carve out on the exclusive contract, on the negotiations and on the contract. Because if it makes the contract worthless, or if it means that we're not going to have as many shade structures and as much bus furniture, that's an issue we need to know. I want us to have our eyes wide open. At the end of the day, I'm not trying to cast a judgment on the technology that he's talking about, but I do want us to always have our eyes wide open when we move forward. So I cannot accept, as the chair of the committee, I cannot accept my colleague's amendment as well intended as it is, and so I ask for a no vote on this amendment.
Mr. Buscaina.
Thank you. If you look at what's before you here, and Paul, if you can maybe address this, I feel that, you know, we haven't given you much direction on what is a priority. Is the priority interactive kiosks? Is priority big belly trash receptacles? Is a priority Wi-Fi technology at bus stops? And every time you have, you know, these carve-outs, I mean, the technology is it's no different than the carve-out that is indicated here in E, F, G, H, I, and J. So how do you respond to that?
Mr. President, Paul Smith, CLA. You're going to give us a set of instructions to go back and look at this contract to make some decisions and to make sure that transit products are delivered. We have revenue that's coming in over the term. We can do this in a way that makes sense. We can incorporate the digital aspects of this conversation here today is in many ways about enhancing the public space with additional opportunities for citizens, for tourists, for people visiting the city.
Yeah, so every time we're adding additional amenities like big belly trash receptacles, like Wi-Fi network technology and bus stops, we're taking away the revenue.
Right? Yes, that's a
I feel that, you know, adding a technological component to this is no different. But, so, colleagues, I ask for an aye vote on 8B.
Just for clarification, the contract as it already stands allows the contractor to provide those materials. And I think if we went into a negotiation, we would want to make sure that kind of information technology is provided in keeping with the current contract.
And when we agreed on this contract nearly 20 years ago, the
I mean, obviously, interactive kiosks or the technological advances didn't even exist then, right? Wait. So why are we limiting ourselves to not having a carve out to look at other technological opportunities as it relates to the public right of way? So because, that's my point.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mr. Krikorian.
Thank you, Mr. President. With regard to Mr. Buscaino's suggestion, I really, off the top of my head, like this idea of carving this out because I think there's an opportunity to have a different set of revenues that are maybe outside of this contract. But I'm also, to Mr. Blumenfield's point, I think there are trade-offs every time you do something like this. I think I would feel more, although I'm inclined to be supportive of this, I would feel more comfortable, I think, if a committee at least had the opportunity to consider that, whether it's Public Works or budget or otherwise, but just to have some analysis of what the plus and minus is, if that could come back to us quickly, is there any reason we wouldn't want to just have it considered by Mr. Blumenfield's committee, for example, and reported back? Because under 4A, I'm sorry, 8A, negotiation, we would be instructing staff to begin a negotiation. That negotiation isn't presumably going to take place over the next 2 weeks. It's going to take place over some months. In fact, we've put a 120-day negotiation time frame on it before an RFP would be prepared. So over the course of that time, the committee could consider it, make those evaluations. Maybe we could even get a bit of a financial impact analysis from the CAO or the CLA. Mr. Buscaino, I think I would feel more comfortable if we had that kind of an analysis before us, even though I'm supportive of the substance of what you want to do. I think we would be better served if we had a little bit of opportunity to have committees consider that. So I offer that to both of you as a suggestion, if that would be acceptable to you.
Thank you. I have Mr. Blumenfield.
Yes. No, and that is what I offered up to start this was saying as a compromise amendment, and I'm prepared to offer that if this amendment fails, which is to bring it back so that we have our eyes wide open. I do view this as different than the other things in here. Everything else that we instructed in the committee about shade structures and all the transit amenities are things that are permitted within the contract structure. The thing, what this does, which is so different, which is why I think we need to analyze it, is it removes the exclusivity of the contract, which is the prime value of the contract, is it is an exclusive in the right-of-way. If we are going to take that exclusivity out, I want to know what the impact is going to be. And maybe could you, Bob, tell us, am I wrong when I say that in terms of all the things that are in there are part of the we're just putting an emphasis on, but tell us a little bit about the difference in the carve-out versus the other things that were instructions.
Yeah. Your comments are on the mark, but we already have two carve-outs already. The bus bench program has an advertising program, and we have the banners on the light poles that also have things. So we already have two places where that is already carved out. And you're right, we have... If 8A passes, there's a bunch of things we have to work with the contractor and find and make sure that our revenue stream back to the city is in keeping with what we desire it to be. So it's a dance. It's a negotiation, and we want to do.
Okay. Thank you. So, Mr. Buscaino, I'm prepared to offer an amending motion to restructure it, or you can obviously. And I'm prepared not to do that if you want to go ahead with the vote on it. It's up to you.
Well, in position to respond right now? You want to think a moment because I do have another speaker on the queue, Mr. Buscaino, if you wanted to take some more time. Mr. Bonin?
Thank you. I've been sort of intrigued by the discussion between Mr. Blumenfield and Mr. Buscaino, and the more I hear about that and the impact it would have on potential revenue, it makes me think, this is the kind of discussion that would be well suited to an RFP, because you may have someone who's offering to respond who'd be more flexible about
the exclusive or non-exclusive use of the right-of-way. And we wouldn't know that until we do that. But I understand the rationale behind what you're recommending, for sure. But correct me if I'm wrong, aren't the bus benches on a separate track from the bus shelters and everything else in the street furniture contract?
Once again, Lance Sarisha of the Bureau Street Services. Yes, the bus bench contract and the advertising format that they utilize is actually a separate market segment that is sought after, basically, from the Coordinated Street Furniture Program. And so they actually complement each other, but we did give out front JC Deco that exclusive right, and so therefore we needed to create that carve-out for the bus bench program itself, even though it's not competing directly with
it. And who has the bus bench?
A company called Martin Outdoor Media.
When does that expire?
That contract is currently set to expire in 2021 as well.
In 2021. So why wouldn't you recommend that instead of doing 10 years for this, we do 3 years so that we get to do the bus shelters and the bus benches? Wouldn't it make sense to do them sort of holistically as a package?
That's entirely possible. We were seeking out council's guidance in that regards.
But what was your recommendation?
Well, once again, our recommendation was to move forward with seeking out an amendment to seek to achieve or receive benefits sooner than later. We could start receiving additional transit shelters within several months versus, 4 or 5 years from now.
Yeah, I totally get that. I mean, as chair of transportation, making it easier for folks and friendlier, more convenient, safer to use public transportation is key. I'm just wondering if there's stuff out there that we're just leaving on the table.
Mr. Buscaglia.
And that too, like Mr. Bond, is my main concern. You know, if we feel that the city's not getting its bang for the buck, then why not put this damn thing out back on the street? And when we talked about this in committee, I wasn't too keen or too aware on the exclusivity part. In a time where technology is emerging, why limit ourselves? So go with the amendment. If it fails, I just completely just not agree with the entire, and I'll just vote the whole damn thing down myself.
Okay. All right. So, Madam Clerk, then how do we do this? Is it the vote on the amendment? Is that the first vote?
Yes, sir. First of all, there is a verbal amendment by Councilmember Blumenfield to send this matter back to committee for 30 days for further analysis. However, there needs to be a second on that one.
To send item 8B back to committee. That's what I had understood.
There is an amendment that was passed out, and it's noted as, no, it's the last amendment that was introduced, and that
so
is.
So the last amendment, so what we'll be voting on is Mr. Blumenfield's amendment. I think it was seconded by, I think, Mr. Kerkorian. So that's the first vote before this body. So if I have it correctly, Mr. Blumenfield will be asking for an aye vote. Mr. Buscaino will be asking for
communication. There's 8A. You're referring to basically 8B as amended, which I never formally amended it, but I'm happy to. I was going to give him a chance to have this straight vote either way. So 8A, we have agreement on. It's 8B that there's the disagreement on, which is Mr. Buscaino's amendment. So we can
So, but since Mr. Buscaino is requesting that there be a vote on his amendment, I think that in fairness to him, that we will do that vote first. So that is what, Madam Clerk, what item is the motion?
Amendment 8B on the agenda is motion
It was, what was that again?
Okay, Amendment 8B on the agenda is amending Motion Buscaino Bonin, and that is to instruct the Bureau of Street Services and CLA with the assistance of the city attorney to negotiate a contract extension with J.C. Deco that specifically excludes digital interactive media kiosks which display sponsored content while in passive mode and provide directory applications to draw residents and visitors to nearby restaurants, hotels, shopping events, and civic resources, and that the term public amenity kiosk be defined to exclude such digital interactive media kiosk. But Mr. President, today amendment, it was stamped motion 8A should be, for clarification, motion 8C as in cat, and that is motion Krikorian Blumenfield Wesson. Since that was introduced today and 8B was motion Buscaino Bonin was introduced on Wednesday, 8C Krikorian Blumenfield Wesson motion should be voted on first, sir.
Mr. Wezar. Mr. Wezar.
Thank you. For a point of clarification, is the motion to move item 8B to committee still on the table?
At this moment, no.
Okay.
So again, what is on before us now is identified as 8C.
Yes, sir.
That is a Blumenfield Krikorian.
Yes, sir.
Correct?
That is to...
Okay, so wait. Come on, let's vote on that item then. Members? All right, so this is Matt. Hey, you know what? Members, we're going to vote on 8C, which actually does what, Madam Clerk? 8C?
8C revises recommendation I1G of the committee report, as well as it revises recommendation 2 of the committee report, adds recommendation 3 to the committee report, and adds recommendation 4 to the committee report. And that is, again, motion Krikorian Blumenfield, second by Councilmember Wesson.
Okay, so that is what's before us. Let's open the roll, or wait, Mr. Krikorian?
Well, I just, because there was a little confusion with the stamping, so I just wanted to clarify that. The motion that Bob and I presented is stamped 8A mistakenly,
and now
because there is already a recommendation 8A and 8B in the agenda. So this should have been stamped 8C to separate it from what's included in the agenda. So what we will be voting on first is 8C, but it was distributed to you today as 8A.
Gotcha.
That's the reason this is a little confusing.
So let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay. Now what is before us currently?
That would be Amendment Buscaino Bonin, and that is relative to the instruction of street services and CLA with the assistance of the city attorney to negotiate contract extensions that excludes digital interactive media kiosks.
Okay, and this one, Mr. Buscaino is asking for an aye vote. Mr. Blumenfield asking for a no vote. So on this item, let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
Two ayes, 11 noes.
Okay, now Is there a final vote?
So I can offer an amendment now. What I was suggesting, to send it back to committee if Mr. Buscaino would like that amendment. I'm offering, now that that has failed, I'm happy to offer an amendment which would ask the committee to ask for a report back in 30 days on the financial and other implications of doing this carve out on the contract so that we can evaluate that. If you want to second that, then that will be the motion that we put forward.
Okay. So is that the last motion, Madam Clerk, that would be before us?
Yes, sir.
Okay. It's been made by Mr. Blumenfield, seconded by Mr. Buscaino. Madam Clerk, open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
12 ayes, 1 no.
Okay. That brings us where?
That brings council to item number 1. For the record, sir, there is a request to continue item 1D to February 16, 2018, sir.
Without objection. Okay, now let's vote on 1 or the remaining items under 1. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Other items before this body?
No, Mr. President, council has motions for posting and referral.
They're posted, they referred. Announcements, members? Ms. Martinez.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, I just want to remind you that our human trafficking toiletry drive continues through February 9th. Again, your donations, there's a couple of boxes that I've checked that are still empty, so I'm challenging all of you to step up and help us with our toiletry drive. I do want to give a shout out to our friend, Mr. Rue. Mr. Rue, thank you for your donation. I'm acknowledging that you stepped up and you are doing a fabulous job with our toiletry drive. Thank you, sir. Again, shampoo, deodorant, toothbrushes, tampons, they can all be either dropped off on the first, third, or fourth floor here at City Hall. Our monetary donations are accepted as well. I'm happy to take your checks. Thank you very much.
So I've been informed that we have to vote on 8 as a whole, or what, Madam Clerk?
Yes, Mr. President. Council needs to reconsider 8 to vote on item number 8A and B.
Okay, let's vote on reconsideration.
That would be the committee report as well as the amending motion, Buscaino Bonnet.
Wait, I'm.
You just did that. That was okay. On the amendment that Bonnet voted no on.
So you're saying now we have to.
Just saying.
So we're voting on what? Are you saying we need to vote on 8A as amended?
Uh-huh. Okay.
That is
right.
So that's what, yeah. I believe we're being told. So let's vote on reconsideration. Let's open the roll, close the roll. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Now we're going to vote on 8A as amended. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
12 ayes, 1 no.
Okay. Any further any more announcements? Any other announcements?
No on that, please. This thing is all missed.
Let's record Mr. Buscaino, you know, as a no.
Whole thing, yeah.
If all could rise for adjourning motions. All rise for adjourning motions. Mr. Bonin.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, you may have seen the story in the front page of the LA Times today.
Ed Moses, an icon in the arts world, a resident of Venice for decades, passed away on Wednesday at the age of 91. Ed was probably the most notable artist in the city of Los Angeles, one of the most notable in the United States, had an incredible, illustrious career spanning 7 decades, national and international recognition for his work, considered one of our most innovative painters, a central figure in the city's art scene. He often referred to himself as a mutator, more so than an artist, and said he was driven not so much by a desire for self-expression, but by a curiosity to explore and discover. He was an outsider, a contrarian. He was described as a spiritual descendant of the abstract expressionists, although he himself personally defied labels. He worked with a lot of unconventional materials and tools, including mops and hoses and rubber scrapers, and he painted beside his house in Venice, where he lived for more than 30 years, on an open-air concrete slab and in a barn-like studio. He was born in 1926 in Long Beach. He did not start out as an artist or as a painter. He was a surgical technician during World War II. He wanted to be a doctor, but he dropped out from Long Beach City College saying he couldn't memorize the curriculum. So on a whim, he took a life-changing class in arts and enrolled in UCLA's MFA program. His first exhibit was in 1958 at the Ferris Gallery while he was still a grad student at UCLA. He became part of a raucous and innovative group of artists known as the Cool School, which also included Ed Ruscha and some other noted artists here in Los Angeles. His first museum shows were in 1976 at the White Gallery at UCLA. And while he was known really in the 60s and 70s for drawing, he turned primarily to painting by the mid-70s. He was the subject of a major retrospective at MoCA in 1996, and in 2014 he showed at UC Irvine. His work was included at LACMA, at the Museum of Contemporary Art, at the Hammer Museum, at the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, at the Whitney Museum of American Art, and at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. He preferred to describe himself as a painter or as a mark maker and not as an artist, and thought of himself as an experimenter. He was a very distinctive guy. He had a shock of white hair, a big mane, and a beard, was just a big presence and was really loved and revered. Even in his 90s, he kept on painting. He was showing up at gallery showings and openings and was quite the presence. He's survived by his wife, Avilda, his son, Sed, and his family, Pamela, Maxwell, and Violet, son, Andy Moses, and his wife, Kelly Berg. There'll be a memorial celebrating his life sometime in the spring, but probably the most appropriate way to celebrate and appreciate his life is to go see some of his work. And coincidentally enough, on Wednesday, the day he died, they started doing an exhibition of his work at a new gallery at the runway at Playa Vista, which is right next door to Hal's Restaurant, where 5 of his works are permanently installed. It was a place he really loved, and is both a restaurant and an art gallery. So a giant in Los Angeles. I believe one of his works hangs in Mayor Garcetti's office, as a matter of fact, and really put us on the mark, on the map, as an arts capital. May he rest in peace and be long remembered for his great work.
Okay, thank you. So I'm still looking to my left. For adjourning motions, now I'm looking to my right for adjourning motions. I don't see any members. This meeting's adjourned.